And the first step in recovery, and we said in our steps, we're going to go through these three phases. What is the problem? And in the first step, we find out what the problem is. And this is the first step to recovery, is to understand what's going on in your life. And it was said another night in our meetings that probably 95 out of every 100 alcoholics will die never knowing what the problem is in their life. Most of them out there in the graveyard still think it's their wives. Or the job, you know. Or the, like me, I laid it on everything. I got to a point in my life where I thought it was the ice. You know, I really didn't know what the problem was. Until I came to Alcoholics Anonymous, and from some people who had solved their problems, it was from them that they gave me, and they passed this on from the first 40 people on down to me. So I feel very blessed that I am an alcoholic. Not only that I am an alcoholic, but I understand what the problem was in my life. And of course, I found out that the problem is simple. It's a twofold problem. Part of it is in my body, and part of it is in my mind. I have an allergy to alcohol. That is to say, I have an abnormal, something occurs in me that doesn't occur in the average tempered drinker. When I take a drink of alcohol, I experience a phenomenon of crave. I crave alcohol. Once I take a drink, I crave alcohol, and immediately I want another drink, and that drink wants another drink, and that drink wants another drink, and another drink. And that's abnormal. Normal people don't do that. They may or may not take another one. Most of them take one, and then they'll shake it and walk around for a while. And that's the normal way to drink. But I never did drink that way. I was an abnormal drinker. And they would walk around, and they may or may not take another drink. And if they drank two or three real quick like me, they would get sick and vomit. They couldn't handle it that way. And I remember those normal drinkers, they used to always tell me, just take two or three and stop. Well, it's okay if you know how to do that. They was trying to tell me to do something that I didn't understand. When I come to Alcoholics Anonymous, I realize that I'm an abnormal. Something occurs in my body, physical allergy, that does not occur in the average tempered drinker. And once I take a drink, I experience this craving, and I continue to drink, and I go through the well-known spree. And I emerge remorseful with a firm resolution. Quite naturally, anybody would. It would be firm. If you got sick as we would, you would have a resolution not to drink again. You know, that's probably a good symptom of alcoholism. Anybody who says, I'm not going to ever drink anything at it again, he's probably an alcoholic. Now, the only thing that we suggest here is entire abstinence. If you don't take the first drink, you won't never have to experience this. And this is real simple. Now, this is just half of my problem. The fact that I can't drink alcohol is just part of my problem. The main problem of the alcoholic center is in his mind rather than the body. Why do we take the first drink? Anyway. And he says, we become restless and irritable and discontent. We become lonely and then we get bored. And we have all these different emotional things that seem to build up on us. And once these things build up on us, we remember the sense and ease and comfort that would come at once if we take a few drinks of alcohol. So this idea is triggered, this obsession is triggered. The obsession, the idea to drink and depress this pain, overcomes all other ideas. It overcomes the remembrance of the last drinking occasions. It pushes this back into our minds. And then the only thing that we can see is think about the relief we're going to get. And this obsession makes us reach over and take a drink, and that drink sets off the craving in the body, and we go through the well-known spree. And Doctor said in the first step that this thing goes over and over again. And unless we can see and understand the problem, we're a victim of this condition. The mind triggering the body and the body in reverse triggering the mind. But once we understand these two factors, of the physical problem and the mental obsession, the physical allergy and mental obsession, when we understand and see these things, we realize that we are powerless over alcohol. We can't drink it, and we can't leave it alone. Therefore, we're powerless. So once we see the problem, then we can determine a solution. Simple process. Write the prescription. Once the doctor identifies, he makes a diagnosis, then he writes the prescription. If you're powerless, your prescription is power. Power greater than yourself, obviously. And you would like for this power, since we can't work in the body, we don't know anything about the allergy, we believe that the power would have to work in the mind. Therefore, came to believe that a power greater than ourselves could restore us to sanity. So really, the first two steps, we have the foundation. We got the two conclusions that put us in a position for the treatment plan. You know, we got the problem, we got the answer. Now we got to carry out the plan of action. And the next thing it comes to is if you're powerless and the solution is power, then steps 3 through 12 is a plan how to find that power. And we begin in step 3 with this little program of action. See, there's no action in these two steps. The action begins in these next working steps of the program. We begin in step 3. Step 3 says make a decision. Which one do we want? And quite obviously, I think, you know, it's a real easy decision between these two. We don't want to go back to this way. No alcoholic likes this. And really, most alcoholics, if you're new in the program, they don't like the solution. I mean, it's pretty, you know, but it's not a tough decision between the two. I'm thinking everybody, if they could get the first two steps, would choose the second step. They would choose the power. If we make this choice, then this decision involves, we choose this. And if we do this, we have to, in order to have this power, if God's going to direct our lives, there are certain things that we have to get self out of the way. So we make a decision to turn our will and our lives to the care of God as we understand it. And therefore, God is going to become the director of our lives. And this is a tough choice for the new alcoholic at this point. It was tough for all of us. Well, once we make this decision, then we have to go to work to clear away the things that block us from this decision. You know, we alcoholics, we have a lot of things going on. There's no way God can carry out this decision in our lives. You know, we alcoholics, we make a lot of bargains with God. You know, I used to say, God, if you do this, I'll do that. You know, but I never really made this decision. I made a lot of deals with him, and I told him what I was going to do and all these different things. And nothing ever did happen in my life. So these things did not work. So I think this brings to mind one of my favorite stories. This is quite a spiritual story.